This episode is supported by Skillshare. There are some problems computers just can't solve.
Computer, what is the meaning of life?
Will I ever stop being a disappointment to my family?
Who do you think would win between a platypus and a wombat? But today, I wanted to talk about one problem in particular called the Halting Problem. It's a really cool piece of computer science, and I think the most interesting thing about it was actually the way it was answered. But before we get into that, let's talk about how it came about. See, in 1928, the mathematician David Hilbert, who even has his own space named after him, challenged the mathematics community with three questions especially close to his heart. Number one, is mathematics complete? Can we prove everything that's true? Number two, is mathematics consistent? Does it give us non-contradictory answers? And number three, is mathematics decidable? Meaning for every mathematical problem, is there some kind of step-by-step method we can take that will tell us whether a statement is true or not? Hilbert was an optimist and thought all questions would be answered with a resounding yes. As he famously put it, in mathematics, there is no ignorabimus, roughly translating to, there is no we cannot know. It was Hilbert's third question which got a young mathematician, Alan Turing, thinking about another seemingly different problem. He wondered, can we write a program to tell us whether any other program will halt or run forever? This is now known as the Halting Problem, and to understand it properly, we first need to talk about programs and inputs. A program is just a sequence of instructions written in a language that a computer can understand. For example, for the question, given two values, x and y, does x evenly divide y? We can write a program that takes y and divides it by x. If the remainder is zero, the program returns a yes. If the remainder is anything else, it returns a no. But the question, does x evenly divide y, doesn't make any sense unless we give it some values for x and y. These are called the inputs, and programs will behave differently given different inputs. Some more complicated programs can even have other programs as inputs, and some can even have themselves as inputs. Now that we've gotten that out of the way, we're ready to talk about the halting problem. So first, let me tell you why this is such a big deal. There's a famous question in mathematics called the Goldbach Conjecture, and it goes, can every even number greater than 2 be written as the sum of 2 primes? Although every number we've ever encountered is the sum of 2 primes, we haven't come up with a way to prove it. We've kind of just brute forced it. That's why even though it's probably true, it's still considered a conjecture. But what if we wrote a computer program that went through all the even numbers and ran an algorithm that checked all the different ways to write this number as 2 positive whole numbers, x plus y? When it finds 2 primes, it moves on to the next even number. If it fails to find a prime value for x and y, it stops and prints out this message. If this program ever stopped, we'd know that it had found an even number that wasn't the sum of 2 primes, so the Goldbach conjecture would be proven wrong. But how long do we let it run before we decide it's been enough? A year? A million? The age of the universe? If we could write a program that could tell us whether this program ever halted, we could solve the Goldbach conjecture and many others like it. That's why the halting problem is so important. Can we find a program that can predict whether any other program and its input will halt or run forever? Turing answered this in a really interesting way. He first imagined that such a program does exist. Let's call it Hal. Hal claims he is capable of saying whether any other program and its input will halt or run forever. But what if we built another program, Barry, who does the opposite of what Hal predicts? So if Hal outputs halts, Barry runs forever. And if Hal outputs runs forever, Barry halts. Seems simple enough. So let's see what happens when Barry is given a random program, Randy, as input. Barry does the opposite of Hal, so he first needs to know what Hal would say about Randy. Does he halt or run forever? So he runs Hal with program and input Randy. If Hal returns Randy halts, Barry runs forever. And if Hal returns Randy runs forever, Barry halts. So far, so good. Now the genius thing that Turing did was ask Barry to use itself as input. So just like before, he needs to look at what Hal would say so he can do the opposite. He runs Hal with program and input Barry. And if Hal returns Barry halts, then Barry will run forever. And if Hal returns Barry runs forever, he'll halt.
If Barry halts, Barry runs forever. And if Barry runs forever, Barry halts. What? We've reached an impossible contradiction. Barry can't both run forever and halt, so Hal can't exist.
It was by this way of contradiction that Turing proved that the halting problem is impossible. We can't write a program that will tell us whether any other program will halt. In the same paper, Turing also managed to answer Hilbert's third question, that no, mathematics is undecidable. There are some problems that we simply can't solve. The philosophical implications of this are pretty interesting. The human brain has often been compared to a computer, and actually when Turing wrote his paper, he didn't even have machines in mind. He was thinking of the people that carried out computations with pen and paper. If the human mind is just a complicated program, that means there are problems we fundamentally can't solve. Not because of limitations on technology and time, but because the halting problem says so. This video focused mainly on the theory of computation, but if you'd like to complement that with the more practical side of things, Skillshare.com has loads of classes to teach you programming. You can learn a variety of different programming languages like Python, Java, and C++. Even if you've never programmed before and you have no idea what any of those words meant, Skillshare is very beginner-friendly, giving step-by-step instructions from installation to more advanced aspects of coding like data visualization and GPU programming. But if programming is not really your thing, Skillshare still has plenty of classes for you to explore, like this one on how to make French macaroons. Skillshare is offering a promotion to my viewers where you can get the first 2 months totally free. Just sign up using this link on screen and in the description. Just quickly before you go, one of my viewers from the University of Aarhus, Denmark, has created this game where you can try and solve the same kind of problems as quantum computers. I know it sounds hard, but it's really fun, and the data will help scientists study the differences between the way we solve problems compared to the way a quantum computer would. It's a good cause, and all you have to do is play a game. Links are in the description. Thanks for sticking with me to the end here, guys. I really appreciate it. I hope you enjoyed the video, and I'll see you next week. Bye!